So if you want to turn to John, we're going to pick up where we've been in John. You can follow along on the YouVersion app. I put my outline on there, and I did put some extra goodies in there, just some songs that are fitting for the season that I've been listening to, and just good reminders. A couple of my favorite bands, Cutlass is in there, and Crowder's in there. Some really good songs, so give them a listen. If you don't like them, I can't help you with that. But anyways, yeah, we're going to be picking up in John. I'm going to pray real quick, and then we're going to get going. Jesus, thank you for this evening. I thank you for just the rhythm of church and how coming to church and doing service and everything, it reminds us of Sunday morning, yet here we are on a Friday night, here to worship you, here to reflect on the greatness of your act of dying for us, of giving up yourself as a sacrifice on our behalf. To pay the debt so that we could be redeemed. I pray that as we study tonight that you would just give us just a newness and a new appreciation for the love that you poured out for us on the cross. That we could truly be appreciative, that we could truly praise you and thank you for that work, that finished work, as we're going to see as we study tonight. I thank you for your word. I thank you for John and his faithfulness to the call, that he stuck with you, stuck by you, stuck near you through all of it, and wrote it down so that we could study, so that we could know of this event from his record. Bless us as we study tonight, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, like I said, we're going to be hopping back into where we left off in John. We kind of took a detour because I wanted to set it up this way where we could pick up on Good Friday and then pick up on Easter and just continue on. And we're going to be finishing up John probably in the next 2 or 3 weeks. So that's kind of nerve-wracking for me, because that means I'm then picking our next study. I'm a little nervous, but it'll be good nonetheless. So just to get us caught up on where we were before we left off, and we went and we explored some of the prophecy that was involved and that was looking forward to Jesus on the cross. We left off in John 19. In John 18, we saw Jesus arrest in the garden, and then his pre-trial questioning and Peter's denial. And then not in John, there's more trials that happen throughout the early morning hours. And then Jesus is brought to Pilate's court, and we saw that interaction in the latter half of John chapter 18 and then John chapter 19, and how Pilate just kept asking Jesus questions. He's wondering why the Jewish leaders could be so mad at him, and the more questions that Pilate asked, the more the answer came back to being that Jesus was innocent. This was a fact that Pilate declared more than once throughout the questioning, throughout the trial process. And then we see closing out chapter 18, where Pilate gets this great idea to substitute this kind of rebel who was probably a murderer in Barabbas. And so he's like, hey, maybe they'll do a trade. That doesn't go well. The people shout that they want Barabbas to go free and not Jesus. And so then Pilate decides that he's going to have Jesus scourged and beaten, and hoping that he can maybe conjure up some sympathy within the hearts of the people, but that strategy doesn't work. And so Pilate decides he's going to kind of make no decision. And he washes his hands, declares Jesus not guilty, but then releases him to the mob. And that gets us caught up. That happens in 19:16. It says, then he delivered him to them to be crucified. And so they took Jesus and they led him away. And we'll be picking up in verse 17. And our passage is a little long tonight because we're going to be finishing out chapter 19. So I'm not going to read the full account. We'll just break it up and study as we go along. So the first little part, I have three questions actually to start for the outline. And the three questions that we'll be looking at is, number one, what happened as far as the events of the cross go? And then what does it mean? We'll be looking at some of the imagery and some of the prophecy within the cross. And then what do I do about it? So we've looked at what happened. We've looked at what it means. So now how does it affect me? How does it affect you? And so those are the questions that we'll be looking at. And so to bring us up to speed, all of Jesus' arrests and trials, they occurred very early in the morning. Scholars say that Jesus' crucifixion probably took place from 9 a.m. was when he was first nailed to the cross, to about 3 p.m. And it was dark from about from noon to 3 as Jesus was on the cross. And to get a full understanding in all of the details about the crucifixion, we would need to read all of the gospel accounts. But for tonight, we're just going to be looking at John, and we'll kind of supplement some details here and there from the other gospels. But we're mostly going to be focusing on John. And so with that, what happened? Verse 17 says, and he, bearing his cross, talking of Jesus here, went out to a place called the place of a skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him and two others with him, one on either side and Jesus in the center. Now Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Then many of the Jews read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Therefore, the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, do not write the King of the Jews, but he said, I am King of the Jews. Pilate answered, what I have written, I have written. Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts, to each soldier a part, and also the tunic. Now the tunic was without seam, woven from the top in one piece. They said therefore among themselves, let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, they divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Therefore the soldiers did these things. As we begin, John says, Jesus, bearing his cross, went out to the place where he would be crucified. And this was the custom of the day. The Romans would have the guilty person carry their cross out to the crucifixion site. But if we add some info from Mark chapter 15 and from Luke 23, we learn that Jesus was unable to carry his cross all the way there. So the Roman soldiers kind of enlisted this guy, kind of made him do it. Simon of Cyrene, they made him carry, he was forced to carry Jesus' cross for him the rest of the way. One of the things that was evident throughout Jesus' trial, like I mentioned before, was Jesus' innocence. Pilate kept running into that fact. Jesus was innocent. He did not deserve. He didn't know why the Jews were bringing him. All of their claims against him were false, as far as Pilate could tell. And Pilate declared many times that Jesus was innocent. Warren Wiersbe adds some insight along with this fact. He says, one thing is sure, the bearing of the cross was a mark of guilt, and Jesus was not guilty. If you were carrying a cross, that means that you were a criminal, you had been condemned in court, and you were headed to be punished. So, within Jesus not being able to carry his cross and Simon picking it up and carrying it for him, Jesus is kind of left without this mark of guilt that would have been associated with every other person that was ever crucified. Which is very fitting because Jesus was innocent. Jesus was the innocent, spotless lamb being led to that place where he would become a sacrifice. And then another requirement of the crucifixion was for the criminal to have a placard nailed to the cross announcing their crime. John lets us know the title that was given to Jesus and the point of contention that it was between the chief priests and Pilate. He says, "Now Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Then many of the Jews read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Therefore the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, do not write the King of the Jews, but he said, I am King of the Jews. Pilate answered, what I have written, I have written." A couple observations about the title that was given to Jesus. John says here that the place where the crucifixions took place, it would have been very busy. A lot of traffic would go through there. A lot of people would pass by. So Pilate records the title in three languages, in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. And within that, there's an example that Jesus' death was for the whole world. It applies to everyone, no matter where you come from. And John Corson breaks it down this way. He says, Hebrew was the theological language, Greek, the intellectual language, Latin, the political language. And he says, let those who view things theologically, let those who view things intellectually, and let those who view things politically know this, Jesus is King. So no matter your background, no matter your worldview, no matter who you are, Jesus is King, no matter what. That applies to everybody. And I think that through all of the interviewing, through all of the questioning, Pilate knew the truth about Jesus. And this title that he gave was, I think that it was a little bit of him sticking it to the Jewish establishment, like, I'm really upset with you guys for getting me up so early this morning, and I really think that you're all crazy. And so it was kind of his way of sticking it to them. It was his way of being like, you know what? I'm the authority here, and you're not. But we have for us, in the person of Pilate, an example of what not to do. He was presented with the truth. He was staring Jesus in the face. He interviewed him. He knew the truth, but didn't act on this knowledge. He had his opportunity with Jesus, but he missed it. Don't let that be you. Don't let your opportunity with Jesus pass you by. And as we move on, we see the prophecy Jesus fulfilled during his time on the cross. Verse 18 says, where they crucified him and two others with him, one on either side and Jesus in the center. And then 23 and 24. Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts, to each soldier a part, and also the tunic. Now the tunic was without seam, woven from the top in one piece. They said therefore among themselves, let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, they divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Therefore, the soldiers did these things. As we move on, the prophecy, John links the prophecy of the Old Testament from Psalm 22 and from Isaiah 53, talking about in Psalm 22:16. I'll read it to you. Says, for dogs have surrounded me, the congregation of the wicked has enclosed me, they pierce my hands and my feet. talking about, it mentions the congregation of the wicked surrounding him. Jesus was crucified between two thieves, between two men who were convicted felons. And then Isaiah 53 mentions that he was numbered with the transgressors. Isaiah 53:12, therefore I will divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bore the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. So Jesus, he's here being numbered as a criminal, but he's innocent, and that was prophesied back in the Old Testament. Psalm 22:18 also predicts that the actions of the soldiers. John quotes it here in verse 24, saying they divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. And then in Exodus 28, it mentions the requirement for the priestly garments, that he would have to have a woven one piece, it would be all one piece woven together. There's some imagery here of Jesus being our high priest, presenting himself to the Father on our behalf. And so those are kind of the happenings of the cross. And as we move on, we'll still be looking at and still dealing with the happenings. But now we're going to be transitioning into the second part of the outline and the second question, which is, what does it mean? As I was studying, I noticed that there is a lot of imagery present in these verses. So that's what we're looking for here, is the imagery, the prophecy, what's behind all of this record that John has for us in the next verses. Verse 25, it says this, now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of, and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. Then Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing by. And he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. And then he said to the disciple, behold your mother. And from that hour, that disciple took her to his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it to his mouth. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. The first thing we see here are the people present at the cross. There are four women and John, and this interesting charge that is given to John regarding Mary, Jesus' mother. And within Jesus' actions here, we see him bypass the earthly bloodline and establish a new family. Psalm 69:8 mentions this, and I'll read it to you. Psalm 69, verse 8, it says, I have become a stranger to my brothers and an alien to my mother's children. Jesus had half-brothers and half-sisters. Matthew 13 tells us who they were. But none of them were present, nor did they believe in him at this point in time. So Jesus passes on the responsibility of caring for his mother to the one who is willing to risk it all to be present at the cross, and that is John, the writer of our gospel. John Corson gives some imagery behind this display. He says, a family is formed at the cross because that's where true families are forged and held together. There's dual meaning here. Jesus' death created access for a whole new family to be adopted through rebirth into the Father's family, into the family of God. That's us. That's the church. What Jesus did on the cross gave us that opportunity. And also, it gives an example for the strongest foundation that we can build our families on is the cross of Christ. When he is our foundation, you can't be shaken. And as we move on into verse 28, we see Jesus in full control on the cross as he fulfills prophecy yet again and finishes the work of propitiation, redemption, sacrifice, and salvation. It says, "After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, 'I thirst.' Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine and put it on hyssop, put it to his mouth. And when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, 'It is finished.' And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit." Verse 28 was prophesied in Psalm 69:21, which says, "They also gave me gall for my food, and for my thirst they gave me vinegar to drink." One thing that I've mentioned as we've studied from Jesus' arrest to his trial to his interviewing with Pilate is that Jesus is in full control of the situation. And he is still in full control, even as he's nailed to the cross, of the situation. And through his actions, he fulfills scripture, he fulfills the law, he fulfills the sacrificial requirements, and as we saw, he fulfills his duties as a son, making sure that his mother would be taken care of. And he also finished the work that was ours to do. Jesus cries out in a loud voice, "Tetelestai" is the word in Greek, which means it is finished, it stands finished, and it always will be finished. There's no more to add to what Jesus has done. The work that he accomplished is finished, it stands finished, and it always will be finished. And so for us, as Christians, we get to lay claim to this finished work of Christ. Another distinction that John Corson makes, he says, "Tetelestai, every other religion and cult bases its teaching on what one must do. Only true New Testament Christianity bases a belief system not on what remains to be done, but on what Christ has already done." And he adds this story about a man named Alexander Wooten. He says, "Alexander Wooten, a classic evangelist of the last generation, was interrupted by a young hoodlum who said, 'Hey, preacher, what do I got to do to be saved?' Wooten said, 'You can't.' And the next day, the young man was again in attendance with the same question, to which Wooten gave the same answer. The last day of the crusade, the young man came again, saying, 'Please, what do I got to do to be saved?' 'You can't do anything,' Wooten said. 'It's been done. Son, just enjoy it and receive it.' And the young man was saved and went on to become Wooten's assistant." John Corson then says, "Wooten was right. We can't do anything to get right with God or closer to God except to realize that it's all been done. It's all been done through Jesus." And as we continue in our walk, we continue to say, "I'm coming to you, Father, expecting your blessing and confident of your grace, not because of who I am, but because of what your Son accomplished when he cried, 'Tetelestai, it is finished.'" And for us as Christians, that is one thing that sets us apart. Like John Corson said, from all other religions try to reach up to God. They try to make a way to God. Where, for us, God has made a way for us. He's come down to us in the person of Jesus to make a way so that we could get to him. Not us trying to work our way there, not us trying to do it on our own strength or our own volition or our own worth, but on Jesus and his worth. And Jesus gives up his spirit, finishing the work In verse 30, so when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished," and bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. And then we're just going to briefly touch on verses 31 through 37. It says, "Therefore, because it was the preparation day that the body should not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who was crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. And he who is seen has testified, and his testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, so that you may believe. For these things were done, that the scripture should be fulfilled, not one of his bones shall be broken. And again, another scripture says, they shall look on him whom they pierced." So, in this portion of it, John points out that the Jewish leaders are getting antsy, and they just want to get it over with. They want to get out of there and get to dinner. So they're like, "Hey, let's get this over with quickly." And so something interesting that was also pointed out as I was studying was the fact that the Roman soldiers, they don't do what they're commanded to do. This would have been very rare, because that was something that the Roman army kind of prided itself on, was this model of authority. And if you were under authority, you did what was told of you. And so when they were ordered to break the legs of everyone there on the cross, the fact that they did not break Jesus' legs, well, it's biblical in proportion, and God ordained it. It was pointed out that the Roman soldiers didn't do what they were commanded to do, but they did do the thing that they were supposed to do in piercing Jesus' side. They fulfilled scripture, as John points out in 36 and 37, saying, "For these things were done, that the scripture should be fulfilled, not one of his bones shall be broken." And again, another scripture says, "They shall look on him whom they pierced." And within these verses, we have the testimony, the proof that Jesus actually died. He was not mostly dead. He was all dead. We have the testimony of a soldier in verse 31 through 34. Roman soldiers of the day, they were around death. They knew death. I'm sure that them looking up at Jesus, they would have known if he was dead or not. We have the testimony of an eyewitness. Verse 35, John says, "Hey, I was there. My testimony is true. I saw what I saw, and I will claim what I saw as true." He says, "And he who has seen has testified, and his testimony is true. And he knows that he is telling the truth, so that you may believe." He passes on this eyewitness information, not to like boast about it, but so that we may believe. The later readers, the people that later are reading about his account and what he saw while he was there, it was written so that we may believe. And then we also have the testimony of Scripture. And John quotes from the scripture in 36 and 37, the prophecy that has predicted these events, and how they've now taken place. So Jesus' work on the cross, what does it mean? It means the scripture's fulfilled, the word of the law and the prophets is fulfilled, and the work of redemption and the debt for our sins and the sins of the world, it's all paid. It's all fulfilled. Jesus, as the sacrificial lamb, none of his bones were broken. He was the perfect example, the perfect sacrifice that was accepted by the Father. But now, Now that it is finished, the question is, now what do I do about it? How does it affect me? How does it affect you? And the answer is found in the closing verses of John 19. It says this, verse 38. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. And Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took the body of Jesus, and Nicodemus, who at first came to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds. Then they took the body of Jesus and bound it in strips of linen with the spices, as the custom of the Jews is to bury. Now, in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had yet lain. So there they laid Jesus because of the Jews' preparation day, for the tomb was nearby. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. Interesting characters, both members of the Sanhedrin, both, as John points out, secret followers of Jesus up to this point, but these men who were once afraid to be associated with Jesus are now boldly declaring their allegiance to him. They have a burial site set aside and planned out. They have spices and burial provisions ready, and they take care of Jesus' body despite the fact that they are now identifying themselves with him and also disqualifying themselves for the celebration of the Passover. For in handling Jesus' dead body, that would declare them unclean and therefore unfit to celebrate the Passover. And a couple of questions that arise as we read these verses is how? How did they know? How are they able to act so quickly? And then why? Why did they do it? And as many of you may know, I study Warren Wiersbe faithfully and quote him pretty much in all of my sermons. If you ever have like a spare, I don't remember how much this cost, like $80, I think, invest in Warren Wiersbe's commentary because it is rich. But anyways, I wanted to share with you his insight on this event. He said he takes a little bit of, artistic license here to kind of put together a story, but it's very good, and I feel like it sheds a lot of light onto what is going on within the hearts and minds of Joseph and Nicodemus at the time, and how it affected them, how Jesus affected their life. So, as we read, Warren Wiersbe says, all of this raises the question, how did Joseph and Nicodemus know to prepare for his burial? He says, what follows is only conjecture on my part, but to me it seems reasonable. Starting out, when Nicodemus first visited Jesus, he was impressed with his miracles and his teachings, but he could not understand what it meant to be born again. Certainly after the interview, Nicodemus searched the scriptures and asked God for guidance concerning these important spiritual matters. And if you're interested in where that interview is, it's in John chapter 3. You can look it up. He goes on to say, at the critical council meeting recorded in John 7, 45 through 53, Nicodemus boldly stood up and defended the Savior. His associates ridiculed him for thinking that a prophet could come out of Galilee. Search and look, they said, and that is exactly what Nicodemus did. It is likely that Joseph quietly joined him and revealed the fact that he too was more and more convinced that Jesus of Nazareth was indeed Israel's Messiah, the Son of God. As Nicodemus and Joseph searched the Old Testament, they would find the messianic prophecies and discover that many of them had been fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Certainly, they would see him as the Lamb of God and conclude that he would be sacrificed at Passover. Jesus had already told Nicodemus that he would be lifted up in John 3:14, and this meant crucifixion. Since the Passover lambs were slain about 3 p.m., the two men could know almost the exact time when God's Lamb would die on the cross. Surely they would read Isaiah 53 and notice verse 9, and he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death. Jesus would be buried in a rich man's tomb. Joseph arranged to have the tomb hewn out, and the men assembled the cloths and spices needed for the burial. They may have been hiding in the tomb all during the 6 hours of our Lord's agony on the cross. And when they heard, "It is finished, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit," they knew that he was dead and they went to work. They boldly identified with Jesus Christ at a time when he seemed like a failure and his cause hopelessly defeated. As far as we know, of all the disciples, only John was with them at the cross. I thought that was a really cool story. It makes a lot of sense for Joseph and Nicodemus, being the Jewish leaders that they were, involved and studied in the Jewish law. They probably, God opened their hearts. He impressed on them, pricked their souls so that they would be curious as to what Jesus was all about. Why did they do it? Their study of the scriptures that led them to this discovery of the true Passover lamb in Jesus. They were no longer satisfied with the symbol. They wanted the real thing, and they saw it in Jesus. And they were willing to go so far as to defile themselves because the one that they had been waiting for was here, the Messiah, the Passover lamb, Jesus. Was here. As John the Baptist calls him, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Joseph and Nicodemus are examples to us of how to act. If you have questions, seek the Scripture. If you have doubts, seek the Scripture. And then, when you find out what you're looking for, be bold enough to identify with Jesus. If you find your answer in Jesus, be confident enough to step out and identify with him. Nicodemus and Joseph, they were secret followers of Jesus up until this point, but they made the decision to, hey, I'm giving it all up for this guy. And so now to close, I have to ask you the same question that they had to answer. And that is, you know Jesus died. I just read it to you. Jesus died. But do you know why? It was for your sin? For my sin? For everyone's sin, the whole world. The innocent Lamb of God given as the final sacrifice, the sacrifice to end all sacrifices, the sacrifice that when it was done, the earth shook, the veil tore, God was open to everyone. It wasn't exclusive anymore. He's reconciled the world unto the Father. But now, there is a responsibility that is given to us. Nicodemus, Joseph, they searched the Scripture. What was their responsibility? They had to act. They found what they needed to know. They asked the questions. They searched the Scripture. They came to the conclusion that Jesus was their guy. And so now the question then becomes, what are you going to do about it? If Jesus is your guy, now that you know why he died and that he did die, Are you willing to give it up for Jesus? To lay aside your pride, lay aside, confess your sin, and to identify with Christ in his death. It's difficult. It takes, like I said, laying aside your pride, being willing to give up the things of this world, like Joseph and Nicodemus, to give up festivals, to give up celebrations for the sake of Christ. Whatever that may be for you, it doesn't have to be that you are giving up, you know, literal festivals and celebrations, but what does it take? What do you give up for Jesus to identify with him? Because that's what it takes. It takes forsaking the world to identify with Christ. But the sacrifice we make in identifying with Jesus in his death grants us then access to the privilege of being able to identify with him in his life. Because if you don't know the rest of the story, I'm sorry to break it to you, but spoiler alert, just like our video, Sunday's coming, guys. Sunday's coming. And that's the difference. It makes all the difference for us. Jesus is dead, yes, but the story doesn't end there. Sunday's coming. Resurrection Day's coming. But guess what? If you haven't confessed the fact that you are a sinner and accepted Jesus' death as the payment for your sin, you aren't adopted into the family of God and the new life he has for you. You don't have access to Sunday if you don't believe in Friday. And so I'm going to close us, and if you're sitting there, you're wondering, like, man, all right, what do I do? Just remember the words of Alexander Wooten that I mentioned earlier. You can't do anything. It's already been done. Jesus has paid it all. All to him I owe. Just receive it. And so if you're sitting there and you're like, man, Jesus, I want that life. I want that life that you're offering me. I want to lay claim to that sacrifice that you died on my behalf. Then I'm going to close this in prayer. And as I do, I'm going to lay it out there. And you pray along with me. Whatever it may be, it goes something like this. Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know, I confess that I need you. I am dead in my trespasses and sins. And so I want to identify with you in your death so that I too can take hold of that life and accept you as my Savior. I pray that you can make that redemption a reality in my life and turn it into adoption, making me a son or daughter in your family. And I thank you for doing it. I thank you for finishing the work